back in December, we put a request out for questions that either I or members of staff here could answer. So this video, we're going to get them answered.
Anything new in the realms of ingredients that you think we should experiment with?
So I would be looking at hop products. Now, there's been massive research and new hop products coming out. So there's hop products for bittering, for dry hop, and for whirlpool. Now, they're going to bring really consistent results and in some ways much easier to use than the actual raw hop product. So that would be something that I would be really pushing forward. Also, and not necessarily new, but English hop varieties. So we are seeing some English hop varieties now that are coming out that are at least pushing towards that fruit salad type flavour and tropical fruit flavours that hops that are grown elsewhere can bring. So new hops and hop products is something that I would be experimenting with in my brews.
What's the best way to clean a plate chiller? No matter how many times I soak in PBW and rinse, there's still bits coming out.
Yeah, I know how you feel. And actually, the cleaning of a pet plate chiller can be tricky if you get it wrong right from the start. If you get it right from the start, you're on to an absolute winner. The absolute golden rule of cleaning a plate chiller is it has to be rinsed through thoroughly straight after use. That should be the first bit of cleaning that you do when you finish the brew. If you're in a situation where you have got a plate chiller that has not been cleaned correctly, my advice would be to fill the wort side with a really strong PBW solution or similar, fill the water side with water, and then put it in an oven at about 120 degrees for about an hour. I would then bring it out, I would empty it out, I would let it cool down, and then I would pump a hot PBW solution through it until it runs clear, and that should clean it.
What's the best way to bottle beers? From the keg or bottle condition?
I'm going to say bottle conditioned. It's a traditional style of doing it. We've been doing it since the year dot. It takes away a load of complications. And I know that people say that they want to be able to give away clear beer to friends and family. That can be still achieved, bottle conditioning. The rule is the clearer the beer going into the bottle is, the clearer the beer will be coming out the bottle.
Jaffa cake or biscuit?
Cake, obviously. It's not crunchy. It's not been cooked twice. It's a cake.
Post-Brexit, is there any hope for reasonable shipping costs to Ireland?
Yeah, fully understand and fully feel your pain. We are constantly striving to work on our shipping costs to bring them down for the customer. That's both on the back end here, stuff that we're working in the background, and with couriers as well. So watch this space. We do have some news that we can share over the next couple of months, and it will be easier for you.
Ever thought about selling invert sugar?
We have thought about selling invert sugar, and there is invert sugar available. Unfortunately, it's in block form. So we can buy in a 25 kilo block of invert sugar, but we've just got no way of repackaging it, breaking it down in a food safe way, the way that the EHO is going to be happy with. So I'd love to be able to sell it in small amounts to home brewers. It's just not something that we can do.
What made you want to start a brewing shop selling equipment and ingredients?
Well, I was brewing, so I had a really strong interest in it. I was also already in business with my parents, and it was just a natural progression for my hobby, for me to try and then fund my hobby. And then that got a little bit more serious, and all of a sudden we've got 12,000 square foot and 20 staff.
What fermentation vessels do you recommend which can be used for a closed pressure transfer, but also fit in a standard under-counter fermentation fridge?
SS BrewTech Brew Bucket. You have to make a slight modification to the fridge. So most of the under-counter fridges have a compressor at the back. So that's where the little hump is at the bottom of the fridge. They normally have a glass shelf that sits in front of that. If you replace that glass shelf with a piece of ply board that is cut to the right size, you will find that a brew bucket will sit on the hump and the new shelf, and there's enough room in there to be able to have it sitting in there. If you use the blow-off valve that is an accessory available through SS Brewtech, you can then pressure transfer using the smallest amount of CO2 head pressure straight out the brew bucket, straight into a keg or bottle.
What are the folks at Malt Miller HQ brewing at the moment?
So there's always plenty of hazy pails, hazy dippers going on here at the Malt Miller, but we have absolutely fallen in love with lager brewing, and that's really where our main concentration is at the moment.
Any recommendations for pickup tubes or dams to retrofit onto kettles? Interested in going to T90 whirlpooling, so need some adaption.
British brewers are fully accustomed to using whole leaf hops, and with whole leaf hops you need some sort of hop filter in the boil kettle. You need to completely reassess the situation when you're using T90s, because, or any other type of hop pellet. Hop pellets want to block up every single filter that there is, so trying to filter them is almost impossible. If you're looking to use a whirlpool, you have to take a leap of faith and remove the hop filter completely. So the idea is, if you're trying to whirlpool and you've got a hop filter on, you're trying to pull the wort from exactly the place where you're trying to get all of the hop debris built up, which is the center of the kettle. So if you take your hop filter off and you take the wort from the edge of the kettle once you've whirlpooled, you won't get any blockages. So the whole idea is that you whirlpool, then leave the whirlpool to settle, then open the valve on your kettle and draw off clean wort from the outside.
How would you start to build your own all-grain recipes?
Start with a smash. So you are then single malt, single hop, and you can just build your repertoire from there. You are starting to understand the flavours. So first of all, same malt, same hop, different yeast a couple of times, and then same malt, different hop, same yeast, and you can just carry on going like that, and it builds up your knowledge of what flavours do what. Secondly, use brewing software with brewing parameters on it. So it will give you what your IBUs are, what your colour is for the beer, and it will massively help.
Is the BrewTools B150 good for a small commercial setup, and what add-ons are needed?
We've got loads of customers that have bought B150s from us that are using them either commercially to sell the beer or as a pilot plant. But all over the world, BrewTools are selling that system, and commercial brewers are using them. So the first part of the question, absolutely yes. It makes a great pilot kit or your first foray into commercial brewing. Second part of the question is what to add. Well, with BrewTools, the more you add, the less you have to take apart to get the system to work without having to take tri-clamps off through various parts of the brewing system. My advice is to buy it with a two-valve accessory kit and then add on from there.
When lagering a lager, should you leave your lager on the lager yeast in the fermenter? Or is it better to lager your lager off your lager yeast and lager your lager in a corny keg? Large thanks, the Oyster Boys.
Nice one. Just gotta love the Oyster Boys. Right, with a lager, I would ferment it out until it's completely done. Then I would drop it, cold crash it, and I would cold crash it for a couple of weeks. Then I would take it off of the yeast into a corny keg, where I would leave it for absolutely as long as I possibly can, cold, until I just run out of patience.
What do you use to crush grain, and what size gaps are your two crush options?
This is something that constantly gets asked of us, and it's something that we constantly try to educate people. So I can't give you a gap that the mills are set to, because all the different types of mills are different. How wide the rollers are makes a massive difference. The speed of which the rollers turn makes a massive difference. There isn't an answer that I can give you to set your mill to a certain crush size. The grandfather malt mill is easier because it's the same one that we're selling out to various different, you know, to various different people. What makes a massive difference is the size of the grain. So if the malt mills are set to 1 mil, for example, but the plumpness of the grain makes a huge difference. So the malts are all different sizes. So you can refer back to our video that we did for the grandfather malt mill. That will tell you a whole lot more about the whole sequence of crushing malt. But I can't stand here and say, if you set your malt mill to this crush size, it will mill your perfect malt for a specific system. It's way more complex than that. Basically, we have to continually adjust our malt mills, not just for the size of crush that we're being requested for by the customer, but for the plumpness of the actual individual sizes of the grains.
If you don't have space for a kegerator, is there a solution to serving cold draft beer that isn't too expensive?
Yes, there is, although it comes with a caveat. So beer is always best stored cold. So there are methods that you can use for pouring a beer that cool the beer down en route to the pint glass. So basically cool it down using an ice bath. The beer travels through a stainless coil that's in an ice bath, so it gets cooled down en route. That's not a great solution for me because the beer is being stored at ambient temperature. I think that you would be far better off condensing the size of your packaging so that it does fit in the fridge that you are able to supply.
What is the ideal line length and ID for kegerator beer lines?
I can't really give a precise answer on this because the ideal line length is all to do with the pressure that you're serving, the type of beer that you're serving, the temperature that you're serving at, and the type of tap that you're using. However, as a rule of thumb, I would suggest that you start with about 2 meters of 3/16 line. If you find that your pour is then too slow, I would start reducing the size, the amount of that 3/16 line that you've got. So you might not need 2 meters. You might only need half a meter or a meter of line, but that's through experimentation. It's very much, there's so much that's to do with a perfect pour. I can't stand here and tell you this is the exact setup that you'll need. Just use that 3/16 line and through experimentation, just chop it down so that you've got the right pour at the right speed for your specific beer that you're serving.
Which hop do you sell the least of? And do you think it's underrated?
Firstly, I'll take the question in two different ways. So the difference now between T90 or any type of pellet hop and whole leaf hops is absolutely huge. So when we first started Malt Miller, pellets just weren't, no one was using pellets. Now there's been a wholesale change to people vastly using more pellets than they are whole hops. There's still a market for whole hops, but it is really reducing, and it's reducing really, really quickly. And you will see that in the amount of varieties that we're now stocking as whole hops, as opposed to any type of pellet. It also massively goes in fashion, so, and time of year. So sometimes during the summer, some of the lager hops are really not, like the noble German varieties of hops, really aren't that popular. However, during the winter, they're absolutely smashing it. So can't really think of a hop that is really not selling as such. Some of the hops that are really, really underrated are our UK hops. For an example, Olicana and the new one, Harlequin. If you get the chance to use those in a UK Best Bitter or ESB, really go for it because they are massively underrated and really fantastic hops. So here at the Malt Miller, we absolutely love getting questions from our customers, whether they're on email or over the phone. It's part of our job here to educate. So any questions, please let us know. And if you feel that I haven't answered one of those questions in a full enough way without me really waffling on, just shout back and I'll try to answer it further over email for you. So really looking forward to receiving more questions from you. And all now is to say, have a nice day. Thanks for watching the video. See you soon.